it's nice to see some sunshiny faces. We've been praying and praying for rain when we had a drought, and I was sitting at the breakfast table last week with the kids, my boys, and they're like, "Dad, stop praying. No more praying for rain." So hopefully we'll have some dry weather coming up. We're going to start with a quick word of prayer. Father in heaven, we give you glory. For in all circumstances, you are still the sovereign God. Lord, we know there are storms that come into our lives. And yet, you are the God of peace in the midst of the storm. As we worship, may we see you and know you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to turn in your hymnal to hymn number 790. Hymn number 790. We gather together. Please stand together as we sing 790.
We gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. He chastens and hastens his will to make known. The wicked oppressing, thou seest from distressing. Sing praises to his name, he forgets not his own. Guide us to guide us, our God with us joining, ordaining, maintaining his kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we were winning, now Lord was at our side.
Absolutely tomorrow, the place is going to be filled. We have about 59 children signed up at this point, and we always have a few more who come the day of. So the place is going to have lots and lots of life. But what we really need is the life of the Holy Spirit. And so we need your prayers. We need your prayers that, yes, the decorations are wonderful, but that the Spirit of the living God touches the hearts of each child and each adult that's involved, and if that overflows, if the Spirit does that, he overflows into the lives of these families. Keepers of the Kingdom is, in short, reminding the children that we are in a battle, that there is a battle raging between light and dark, truth and lie, God and Satan, that there is a spiritual battle. That God has given these children and the adults all the weapons they need to be victorious in Jesus Christ. One is the sword of the Spirit. Well, this morning, even though most of us in this room are adults, we're going to be reminded that God's word, the sword of the Spirit, we need that too.
Amen.
So with that little bit of introduction, we have some other announcements this morning. Last night we had a wonderful night. Fellowship Hall had a wonderful group of individuals who enjoyed the coffee house. We had a range of music. We even had an accordion playing and just a time of fellowship and worship together. In 3 months there'll be another one of those. And if the Lord decides to really push things, and it'll be doing more often, but right now we're planning once every 3 months. It's just something to look forward to. So I encourage you for that as well. Immediately following the service, all those who are involved in Vacation Bible School, we really need to have a good, short, quick meeting. And tomorrow, please don't come to that at 9 o'clock. If you're participating in leadership, we need at least a half an hour early, because we can't just start the program without gathering for prayer. And so if you are a leader, please try to stay after. And tomorrow you can please be here by 8:30. That would be fantastic. Next Sunday, everybody needs to plan to celebrate. Now, this sounds silly, I'm going to be almost treating you all as if you're teaching Bible school kids. When I count to three, I want you to say hurrah. 1, 2, 3.
Hurrah!
Now, in the Middle Ages, it wasn't hurrah. It was huzzah. That makes sense, right? So on the count of three, we're going to say huzzah. 1, 2, 3.
Huzzah!
Next week, after our service, we are going to celebrate, in a sense, the graduation party of Vacation Bible School. And the whole church, the families are all going to be invited, of the kids who are in VBS, but all of us are having a Vacation Bible School graduation party at Circle Hill Park, just one block away. So the church service is going to be the graduation, and the graduation party is immediately following. So plan on it. Be there. Have fellowship with some of these moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas. And let them know that it's not just the kids that are loved by Jesus. They are loved as well. Because of Vacation Bible School, normally this would be the week of community lunch. We just kind of thought having community lunch and Vacation Bible School at the same time would be a little difficult. So next week, Wednesday, at 12 noon, we have a wonderful, wonderful lunch plan. And so if you know somebody who's available, a senior, who would be great to have some fellowship and get out of the house, come join us. We've been averaging between 50 and 70 people in attendance. We usually pick enough for 80 people, so we always have plenty. So if you know of somebody, come on out. Bring them with you, and let's enjoy the bonds of love and Christ together. Are there any other announcements this morning? Sue. Father in heaven, we just ask that you would pour out your healing hand upon Paul. Lord, he needs a procedure. He needs this defibrillator. We know that you are the great physician. Guide the hands of the doctors, the decisions that are made. Place your hand upon Paul and let him know that you are with him in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Anyone else this morning? Fred?
Yeah.
That's right. Fred is reminding me that during the summer, people are all over the place. And since they're all over the place, choir is going to take a break. It's been practicing and having fellowship, and we're getting ready for them to participate in worship. The choir is going to take a break for the summer and resume again in September. Anyone else this morning? Sharon. Sharon's asking us to think about Christmas already. Absolutely. Operation Christmas Child. Last year, we just had just a wonderful, wonderful outpouring from the congregation. It was like 80 or 90 boxes, something like that. 140-something. Okay, I'm really underestimating. I hope we don't have that tomorrow. We're planning on like 50 kids, and we're going to have like 200 of them. Please don't break that. I don't think you could handle that. But we have at 100 and some odd 40 boxes for Operation Christmas Child. And for those who don't know what that is, Samaritan's Purse is a mission organization. The boxes are not just willy-nilly handed out. They are given freely, absolutely. But not only is the gospel in that box, besides the school supplies and the presents for the kids and stuff, but it's done in such a way that the children are connected to the local congregation.
not just a one-shot deal. Oh, Jesus loves you. Bye. It is, here is a gift because Jesus loves you. And we want to come alongside of you, disciple you, disciple your family. What a blessing that is and an opportunity. So Operation Christmas Child. Anything else, John?
God walks beside us, he guides us, he joins with us, and he ordained that we remain in his kingdom, which is divine. And from the beginning, the fight we were winning, the Lord's on our side, the Lord's on our side, all glory to God.
Amen. Anyone else? Ask for a blessing before we come to pray. Oh Lord, ask right now that you would calm our spirits. For this world is full of, yes, the storms that we talked about earlier, but also the busyness and hecticness of this culture. Lord, help us to be still and know that you are God. Mm-hmm. Help us, Lord, to be here together, ready to worship, to have our eyes on you, not on the craziness of this world, not on the difficulties of our lives, but on the grace and the peace and the joy that comes from knowing Jesus Christ. Lord, we are here to worship. Lift up our voices to your glory. Amen. Will you join with me as we open our hymnals? Hymn number 121. Hymn number 121. If you're able, I encourage you to please stand. Hymn number 121. How majestic is your name?
Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all.
Faithfulness, with my mouth will I make known.
of the mercies of the Lord, forever I will sing of the mercies of the Lord.
And our final song this morning for our time of praise is hymn number 99, Thou art worthy, great Jehovah. Tuesday nights, and we open up the church to let the community know they are loved. It's a group that loves the medieval culture and things like that, and so they make armor, and they practice swordsmanship, and they do crafts about the Middle Ages, and they have a special name or acronym for their name, and I don't even remember it. But it was wonderful. At one point, we asked them to show us some of their wares. And it fit with the scripture. It fit with the very scripture that we're going to be using for Vacation Bible School found in the book of Ephesians. The armor of God. And so, if you look at this picture, it was made about a year and a half, 2 years ago. Bruce Bergman from our church took some of these pictures. And it's exciting that when we reach out with the love of Jesus Christ to the culture, you know what? God's in the midst of that.
Amen.
And so, I'm going to ask you guys to tell me what these things are. I'm going to ask you to yell. When I point at it, I'm going to ask you to yell. I'm going to yell what it is. And you already did that one, but we're going to do it again. 1, 2, 3. Oh, that didn't even read the whole thing. I like it. Let's do that again. 1, 2, 3.
The sword of spirit.
Okay, that's going to be the next one, so get ready. We'll read the whole thing. Right. 1, 2, 3.
Abraham and salvation.
Oh, they are good. We're going to have a good VBS. All right. All right. Here we go. Get ready. 1, 2, 3.
Take up the shield of faith.
And then this one, I'm not going to ask you to read the whole thing. But what is it?
The shield.
talks about having your feet shod or shoed with the gospel of peace. The good news of Jesus Christ that fills all those broken places. Our world, and even our churches, are filled with broken people. And broken hearts, and broken families. But there is good news. There is good news. Now, earlier, I had a little bit of hooray. We're going to try that together. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, hooray. Right? One, two, three.
Hooray!
Now we're going to do the song. One, two, three.
Huzzah!
Well, let's pray to God. Jesus, you are a good and loving King.
Yes, Lord.
And we want to be keepers of your kingdom with our shield and sword and breastplate and belt of truth and feet covered with the gospel of peace. Oh, Lord, we love these children. In Jesus' name we say together, amen. Thank you for your abundant grace and mercies, the greatest of which that Jesus died that we might live. But Lord, that you would use us as broken vessels that we are for your kingdom's glory, that we would be instruments in your hand. You are the potter, we're the clay, oh Lord. What an honor. What a privilege. That it's your will, it's your plan, it's your purpose. Lord, as we come to your word right now, open our hearts, open our eyes, help us, Lord. Rebuke the forces of Satan right now, rebuke the lies and the whispers of the evil one and his demonic forces who want to pervert your word. Who want to distort your word. Who want to delude your word. We pray this in the power of the Spirit and in the authority of Jesus Christ. Amen. We're continuing on our study in the first book of Thessalonians. And so I encourage you to turn there with me. The first book of Thessalonians, Chapter 2. Next week, I'll give you a heads up. We'll be having a full service with the theme of our vacation Bible school. And so we'll be taking another momentary break. And that's okay. But we'll slowly work our way through the first book of Thessalonians. Thessalonians, Chapter 2. We'll be starting at verse 17, and we'll read on to chapter 3. In your two Bibles, I believe, is found on page 1256. I think you do. Very good. Jamie's even ahead of you and I. It's really good. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting at verse 17. But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face. Because we wanted to come to you, I Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered. He hindered us. For what is our hope, our joy, our crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are glory and crown. Therefore, when we could bear it no longer, we were willing to be left behind in Athens alone. And we sent Timothy, our brother and God's co-worker in the gospel of Christ, to establish and exhort you in your faith, that no one be moved by these afflictions. For you yourselves know that we are destined for this. For when we were with you, we kept telling you beforehand that we were to suffer affliction, just as it has come to pass, and just as you know. For this season, when I could bear it no longer, I sent to learn about your faith, for fear that somehow the tempter had tempted you and our labor would be in vain. But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us good news of your faith and love, and reported that you always remember us kindly and long to see us as we long to see you. For this reason, brothers, in all our distress and affliction, we have been comforted about you through your faith. For now we live, if you are standing fast in the Lord. For what thanksgiving can we return to God for you, for all the joy that we feel for your sake before our God, as we pray most earnestly night and day that we may see you face to face and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and the Lord Jesus direct our ways to you. May the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. There are probably 5 sermons in that passage that I just read that I can easily see. And we're going to try to touch on almost all those pieces this morning. I promise I will watch the time. And if I can't get to it, then we're just going to have to pick up wherever we leave off. This morning's message is entitled, There Is No Substitute. No Substitute. And I'm going to focus primarily on 2 major points that are related, but they are different. It's almost 2 sermons that I want you to carry with you this morning. First of all, the idea that Satan is real and has real power and is creating real problems. And there is no substitute for the power of our God when it comes to fighting Satan.
Amen.
You have no armor, no defense, no offense, no ability apart from the power of God to defeat demonic forces.
That's right.
There is a lie, there is a untruth, there is a garbage that comes from the pit of hell that our world has been duped into believing. I will share. Witchcraft happens to be something that's on the rise in the United States and around the world. Last night, one of the members who are sitting here this morning was reminding me that the gods of old are back in full strength.
That's right.
The demonic gods that were pagan of old are coming back. And what they're doing is they're dressing up in different clothes. The veils of old, and the astral poles of old, and the ways of worshiping Zeus and Aphrodite and things like that of old are back.
Mm-hmm.
but they're just dressed up in a different way. And witchcraft and paganism of old is fully on the rise. It just now has new clothes. It looks modern and free for today. And I will tell you where the lie comes in. I'll tell you where Satan is doing everything that he always has done. He appears as a child of the light, but he is a liar, a deceiver, a lion seeking who he might devour. Satan tricks people and says, well, if you learn how to do things right, you've got power. If you learn the right magic words, if you learn the right rituals, if you learn the right way to place the candles, the right way to do a sacrifice, the right way to cast a spell, you got power. Balderdash.
That's good.
Absolutely not. The power is demonic.
Uh-huh.
And the person who thinks that they are in charge finds out they are the puppet. It is no different for you and me than drugs. I think I'm in charge, I'm a little depressed, and so I'll take a little something to feel good. I'm not in charge. That drug is in charge. Whether it be alcohol, whether it be crack, whether it be marijuana, whether it be heroin, whether it be crystal meth, whatever it is. When I let something like that change me, it's in charge, not me. And slowly, it takes over.
Mm-hmm.
Slowly, piece by piece, I am less and it is more. There is a real world demonic battle. Oh, this means they serve the glory of children's vacation Bible. We are in a spiritual battle. Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica and says, I have wanted to come to you. I have wanted to see you face to face. And Satan isn't getting in the way. Now, if you don't think that Satan is powerful, we're going to take now not just the New Testament here, we're going to jump way back to the book of Daniel, chapter 10. Daniel is crying out to God. Daniel is laying on the ground, prostrate in prayer. I know, in our evangelical Christian culture, we're used to sitting nice and folding our hands and closing our eyes and bowing our heads. Scripture is full of different ways of praise and full of different ways of prayer. Don't put God in your cultural little box. Use Scripture and say, that's okay, that's okay, that's okay. Well, I don't really do it that way, but David did, and Daniel did. Okay. Daniel was so humbled before the power of his God that he laid his face in the dirt because he knew that compared to his God, he was nothing. And that God chose him and loved him. And Daniel laid his face in the dirt and was in prayer. He did that every day. For 3 weeks, Daniel was praying and praying and praying. Where are you, God? I'm getting no answer. And this is one of those odd Old Testament stories that lets us see behind the veil of the spiritual world and look into the battle that's going on. An angel of the Lord comes to Daniel. And first of all, as almost every time an angel says to a human being, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Get up. That first Daniel kind of gets up a little bit and is now on his knees and, no, get up. I want to talk to you. I want to see you face to face. But God loves us so much. He wants to look us in the eye. He wants us to look in his eye and see the eyes of compassion and grace and mercy. That messenger of God shares something with Daniel. I'm not going to go into what he shares as far as the future of Israel and everything else. But here is a side note that Daniel was told.
The moment you started praying, God heard, and I was sent on my way. But I was detained. The prince of Persia, he's talking about the demon that was behind the leadership and the authority of the earthly kingdom of Persia, the most powerful kingdom of the world of the day. The demonic force that was behind that was holding this angel being back. Wait a minute. God's all powerful.
Yep.
God dispatches his angel to speak to Daniel. And it took that angel 21 days to get there. He said, Daniel, the moment you started praying, God sent you on my way. It wasn't until the archangel, the chief angel, Michael, came and helped me that I was able to defeat the prince of Persia. And now I'm here. And I'll tell you this. Our God is sovereign.
Amen.
And if God wanted that angel there the first day, he would have been there the first day. So please don't misunderstand or misconstrue where I'm going with this. But what I am saying, here is Daniel. Daniel in the lion's den. Here is Daniel. Someone whose faith and commitment and obedience to God was just wondrous. Because there is a real power of darkness that is real. It is not an analogy. It is not fairy tale. It's not make-believe. We are in a battle. Our eyes may not see it, but spiritually, if you have eyes, you will. Our ears may not hear it, but spiritually, if you have ears to hear, you will hear in the language of the world and the value systems of the world and the education that's being poured into our children from the world. You will hear the demonic voices. And there is no substitute. I don't care how educated you are. I don't care how bright you are, how high your IQ is. There is no substitute for the power of the sovereign God.
Amen.
When it comes to fighting Satan.
Amen.
You can study. And I hope you do. You can have a strong character. And I hope you do. You can be courageous. And I hope you have courage. But if that is not built on the foundation of a relationship with Jesus Christ, if that is not built on the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, I don't care how strong you are, your weapons will not work. Paul wanted to go to the church in Thessalonica. If you remember our series, Paul is on his way on his second missionary journey. He's in Philippi, and he gets thrown into prison, and he has a rough experience, but a wonderful experience. God breaks the chains. The earthquake comes. The Philippian jailer is sure that everyone's going to run off. The Philippian jailer is about ready to take a sword. Christ.
Paul goes from there and he goes to Thessalonica. He goes into the synagogue and preaching and preaching and teaching and teaching. He preaches about 3 weeks. And some of the Jewish people who are upset with Paul run him out of town. And he has established this little body of believers, baby Christians. And what? Here's a side note of the sermon, because again, it's really about no substitute. The major no substitute is there is no substitute for the power of the Holy Spirit and God in your life. But here's a little side note. Paul could not judge whether or not they were Christians. Paul could not judge whether or not they truly had accepted Jesus as their Savior yet. He heard their words. He had hope. But because he was torn away, Scripture says, Paul says himself, because he was torn away so quickly, he didn't know if that gospel message was seeds scattered on the path, ready to be picked up by the birds. He didn't know if those seeds of the gospel were scattered in rocky soil. It looks like it's starting to grow. It looks like something's happening. But the sun comes out, a little bit of, boy, I hope we have some sun, but the sun comes out and it withers the plant, and there was no real root. There was no real life. Paul does not know if this church that he established, this little body of baby believers, are they really believers? Or did they just kind of hop on the bandwagon for a little while, but when the going gets tough, they crumble? And so Paul is run out of town, goes to Berea, he's run out of town again, he goes to Athens. A passage even says, when I was in Athens, I couldn't take it anymore. I wanted to get back to you over and over again. I want to see you face to face, but Satan keeps getting in my way. I can't. Paul? Satan stood in the way of the Apostle Paul? The greatest missionary of all time? The one who saw Jesus face to face spiritually and looked into heaven and saw Jesus sitting at the right hand of God the Father? Paul, this mountain man of the faith, Satan stood in his way and Paul couldn't move. Wait a minute, I thought faith could move mountains. When God's will is in line, we can faith that we have. Amen. For whatever reason, it was not God's will for Paul to get back there right away. He does eventually. But it wasn't in Paul's timing. It was in God's timing. But I want it now! How many of you are like me? I am a child of God, and I don't use that in the euphemistic Christian language. Sometimes I have my little pepper tantrums with God. But I want it now! And God said no. Wait. I want to get back to you. I long to see you face to face. And Satan keeps getting in my way. The power of evil keeps standing in front of me, and I cannot move it. Paul, side note again, could not judge whether or not their faith had become real. He knew what they said. It looked good. It sounded good. But Paul wasn't sure yet. The evidence of Jesus in their life had not happened yet. So, when Paul was in Athens, he couldn't take it anymore. He, for whatever reason, couldn't get there. Satan, so Paul says, Timothy, Silas, go back. Go back to Thessalonica. Go back to these baby believers. Let me know what's going on. He goes. He comes back with this wonderful report. What was the report? Yeah, part of the report was Paul, they loved him. And that made Paul feel good. But that wasn't the important part of the report. The important part of the report was Paul, they love Jesus. Paul, they're being afflicted because of their faith and they are standing strong. Paul, they are suffering because of the gospel, and they're not giving up. Paul, it's real. They have a real relationship. Marriages. times of joy, relationships are real. And hold on. All I know as human beings, it takes two, and when there's two, and both are sinful, and both are fallen, even when one tries, the other might not be, and it still falls apart. But in our relationship with God, there is something that is wonderful. God does not fail. So if the relationship is failing, I have to tell you, it's not His fault. And they're hitting those rough times. They are suffering for their faith. And Paul even says, I told you it was going to come. I'm experiencing it. And I told you were going to experience it. And I have to tell you, I'm so excited. I'm so proud. You make my joy complete. Because it wasn't empty gospel. It took root in your life, and you truly, truly have a relationship with God, and you are hanging in there, no matter how bad. You know, the old phrase that, I forget which president said it, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. There is no substitute. There is no substitute for having that spirit within you. There is no substitute for being washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. There is no substitute for having a relationship with God to make it through as a believer in Christ. Not possible. I don't care what self-help book you read. I don't care how many therapists you go to, whether they are Christian or not. I don't care what you do. There is no substitute when we are in a battle against not just the culture, but the demonic princes behind the culture. The Prince of Persia, maybe now he's the Prince of the United States. Jesus himself said in the Gospel of John that this world right now is under Satan. Now I know my God is sovereign. I know all authority has been given to my Savior Jesus Christ. But we still live in a fallen, sinful world, and right now, Satan is alive and well on this earth. Yeah. Why is it so important theologically to truly understand that? Well, if you don't know you're in danger of something, you don't prepare, you don't plan, you don't get yourself ready. My friends, our culture doesn't like to talk about heaven or hell. And if they won't talk about something, they'll talk about heaven, but they want to, even in the church, across the globe right now, we want to almost make believe hell does not exist. We want to make believe Satan does not exist. We just like the warm, fuzzy flower child cupcake theology. And when you live in that world, you don't realize you're in a battle. And I'm going to tell you right now, any nation on earth, if they don't acknowledge who their enemy is, then they are setting themselves up not only for attack, but for takeover. They are setting themselves up for defeat. And Satan has whispered into the church of Jesus Christ for so long, God is love, so nobody will go to hell. God even knows that Satan is such a liar, he uses his own word. Remember when Jesus was in the wilderness? What did Satan quote to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? God's word! Satan takes God's word and he distorts it. Satan uses God's sanctifying work on earth and perverts it. So when Jesus was being tempted, Satan knew that he couldn't speak from his own lips, so he used God's word against Jesus. And Jesus used God's word right back on him. Oh, so what's Satan doing? One, in the church of Jesus Christ, in the body of Jesus Christ, Satan is taking God's word and perverting it. Oh, Scripture says, I would that no man perish, that all come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And if God is sovereign, and he wants everyone to be saved, well, he talks about hell, but it must not really be a real place. I have heard ministers preach that. I've heard Christians believe that. They're listening to Satan. Here is Paul. Paul is in Athens. He is crying out. He wants to know that his baby church that God has helped him to establish, that, is it real? Are these individuals believers or not? And then he finds out that they are. And his joy is full. That first portion of this message is all about there is no substitute to do battle with Satan to the Spirit of the living God. And if you're going to fight Satan with anything else, you will fail. Mm-hmm. There is no substitute, second half of the sermon, there is no substitute for being in a face-to-face relationship fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. We now live in this world where I would imagine most of us are aware that our young people spend more time on their cell phones than they do talking to their parents. They spend more time on their cell phones communicating with their friends than face-to-face with their friends. We live in a culture right now that is no longer face-to-face. Paul could have written a letter to the Thessalonians. Guess what he did? That's what we're looking at today. 1 Thessalonians. And that wasn't good enough, so he said 2 Thessalonians. Paul had the ability to communicate with the church of Thessalonica. He had his cell phone. He could have used it. But what did he long for? What broke his heart? I can't see you face to face. I can't be in your presence. Paul could have written 20 letters. Or 20 texts or emails. But that is no substitute for being present with one another. You can't have a long-distance marriage through a cell phone and really have a real one. I mean, a real personal thing. My wife loves to travel. If you're watching right now, I'm going to be in trouble. She loves to travel, and I love to work. And so I guess we're a match made in heaven. But when she's home, I'm here. There is no substitute for being present together. I am grateful for the cell phone and the email to keep in contact with my son who's in the military and right now on the largest aircraft carrier in the world. But I would trade every text message, every email for an extra day, an extra week of him being home. There is no substitute. But believers in Jesus Christ are so much in the culture of today. Who is the prince of this culture? It is not Christ yet right now. We have been so changed by our culture. And I hear these things, well, I don't need to go to church to be a Christian. You're right, you don't. You are 100% right that being a Christian means that you are a believer in Jesus Christ, washed in the blood. Salvation is individual. You can't get salvation because you just come to church. But it is God's will that we live together as a family. It is God's will that we are in relationship with one another. I know that throughout my marriage, I have spent too much time at work and not enough time with my wife. I know that my wife has traveled too much in her life. She's doing that before we were married, by the way. Anyway, I know that those are truths. And my wife and I need to deal with that. But I treasure those moments that she's home. through and tell us when she's away. You and I have to make sure that we don't grow used to and callous living off our, well, me and my Jesus. I can worship God on a mountain, in the woods, by a stream. I don't need to be with a bunch of other believers. You're right, you can. But there's something missing. Paul has no substitute for being present with this body of believers. He has a hunger and a thirst to have fellowship with brothers and sisters in Christ. We're going to turn real quick to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10, starting at verse 19. Down on page 1283. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus. He's talking to believers. He's talking to Christians. He's talking to the body of Jesus Christ. By the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with true hearts, in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from the evil consequence of our bodies, washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. And here, verse 24 and 25, we're going to focus. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. There is no substitute. Let us consider how to stir up one another, spur one another on, yes, to love and good works. Amen. It's not, Paul didn't say, I believe all of that when Paul wrote the Hebrews, even though he doesn't say it clearly. The writer of the book of Hebrews said that way when I think Paul tells the church, you can't just be happy with you and your Jesus go in the woods and get closer and closer to God. Consider how you will spur one another on to grow in your faith, to be more and more the body of Christ. Consider, think, plan, desire, have your heart's desire be. And the brothers and sisters are more the image bearers of Christ that God has called them to be. If that's not your desire, then I gotta tell you, you've been deluded and deluded by our culture, because our culture loves this idea. Well, it's self-centered one here, and it's all about me and my Jesus. Absolutely, salvation is all about you and Jesus being washed in his blood. But how God calls you to live out your salvation here on earth is in fellowship with the body of Christ. And being a light to those who are lost. It's so easy to say, well, you're the woman. I don't like what you do. Did you see what that person's wearing? Did you see how that person acts? And it bugs you. And then fellowship falls apart. Let me tell you right now, I probably am very annoying to some of you. Some of you are really annoying to me. Oh well, you're my brother, you're my sister, you're my wife, you're my husband. We're a family. We are the body of Christ. I might not like this hand, but I'm not about to cut it off and walk away from it. I might not like that foot. Boy, it almost sounds like a foot to me. Good question, doesn't it? It almost sounds like God's word. There is no substitute. Now, you can be present without being present. You can be in the same car with somebody without being present. You can be at the same dinner table with somebody without really being there. Being here, yes, is a first step. But being here doesn't mean that, okay, it's all good. My wife and I have had our fights. My kids and I have had our fights. My wife and my kids have had their fights. But we've sat at the same dinner table and you can cut the air with a knife. The tension is so big. And I am no different than you and you don't. We can sit at this banquet table called the body of Christ and be present with each other, but not present. There is no substitute for one being together, but what is Paul's real thought? What is Paul's real desire? To be the body of Christ. And I'm going to tell you, it is Satan who wants to rip that apart. Satan cannot take a child of God out of God's hands. But what Satan can do is destroy the relationship between brothers and sisters. Satan can make it apathetic and inconsequential. Satan can turn it into something, oh, I really don't care. Well, that breaks God's heart. Whether someone's right or wrong is irrelevant. I'm going to tell you right now, as we work through, it's taken a while, I know, the book of 1 Thessalonians, Paul is going to tell them where they need to grow. Paul's going to tell them where they're wrong. Paul's going to tell them where they're not living properly. You might look around in this room and see somebody who you don't think is living the way Christ would want them to live. Absolutely, you might be right. Paul loves them. Paul found out that they love him. Even though they don't see eye to eye, even though they might not be on the same page with everything, they were on the same page that they are washed in the blood of Christ, that alone it was Jesus who saves. And the primary group who made up the church of Thessalonica, the Gentiles, they came out of a pagan worship. And Paul looked at them and loved them and knew that there was no substitute for being together. So to close the message, you take two things from today. There is no substitute when you want to battle Satan to the Holy Spirit alone. Is your power, is your weapon, is your defense, is your shield, is your sword. The shield is the defense, but the sword is the offense. And in Jesus' own words, the gates of hell will not prevail. So let's know what that means. A gate is a defensive structure. That means we're supposed to be on the offense, not the defense. You can have a shield to defend yourself against those fiery darts. But we are not supposed to be hiding in our church. There is no substitute. Pick up the shield, defend yourself, but pick up the sword of the Spirit, and the gates of hell will not prevail. Because Satan cannot stand against the power of our God.
Amen.
And living that out, there is no substitute for being an army.
That's right. Go ahead, please.
There is no substitute for being a body. There is no substitute for being the family, the children of God.
Hallelujah.
And if you have grown comfortable with me and my Jesus mentality, then you have been duped by Satan. Because the culture has said, you can do this on your own. You don't need it. And I said, yes. I will you to be in fellowship. I will you to be part of a body, hands and feet and eyes and ears. It is my will And no mature, born-again believer would say, well, I know what your will is, but I'd rather not. Thanks. But no rest. If you have a serious walk with Jesus Christ, it can't just be me and my Jesus. That's salvation. But that's not how God called us to live out our faith. There is no substitute. Let's pray. Father, give us courage, give us wisdom, give us grace, give us compassion. If you are willing to wash the feet of your disciples, if you are willing to humble yourself, then Lord, help each of us who are here today to think less of ourselves and more of our brothers and sisters. Help us, Lord, to spur one another on to love and good works. I cry out to you because Satan wants to whisper into the church of Jesus Christ to tear her apart. I rebuke you, Satan, in the authority of Jesus Christ. Amen. In a few moments, we're going to be singing hymn number 425, Bind Us Together. But I was so excited in preaching that message that I forgot something that I wanted to share or teach. And so I am not going to start a whole sermon over, please don't get worried. In the book of Hebrews, when it says, let us consider how to spur one another on to love and work. I used to break horses. And we wear spurs. A spur was designed not to cause pain unless the horse didn't listen. Let us consider how to motivate each other to love and work. If both are listening, if you watch a rider, like in the song, something like ballet of horses, you don't see spurs, you don't see pain, you don't, the horse and rider are one. They both are working in teamwork. They're working in teamwork and there's no pain. But when one or the other is not being who they should be, they're pain. An inexperienced rider on a real good horse is problem. An inexperienced horse that's fighting the rider, then they're spurs. Or pain. Brothers and sisters, let's consider how to spur one another. Does that mean you need to sit someone down in an uncomfortable conversation? That's what it takes to be the body, to do it. If it means sitting next to somebody and saying, you know what, you know me, but I love you, then do that. But be the body. Hymn number 425, Bind Us Together. Please stand.
Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with
together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together with love.
We continue in our time of worship. As we bring before the Lord his tithes and his offering.
I'm
given to us.
Let this dark world would know the light of Jesus Christ.
Yes, Lord.
That we would ask you, Lord, you use these gifts to fight back the princes of this world. That Jesus would once again reign in the hearts and lives of many women.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Continuing our worship in our time of congregational prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, our Lord, our God, our Master, we thank you that we can boldly come into your presence on the basis of the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that you do care. You care enough to send your Son to die for us, that we might be counted good enough, holy enough, sanctified enough, to be called your children. Not on the basis of who you are, but on the basis of who Jesus is, one of you. We thank you and praise you and adore you for all that you are. Your gifts to us are immeasurable. You have blessed us in so many ways. Ways that we've seen and make fully count. In ways that we now know are useful. Father, we have to confess to you that we are sinners, and that we know how much we love. We know your love. We want to love you and love our neighbor. And we fail to live up to that love. We fail in what we do and what we don't do. And we come before you and bow before you and ask for forgiveness on the basis of the blood of Jesus. Forgive our sins. Change our hearts. Change our lives. We will seek to fulfill your law. For what of you doesn't deserve our love? To love our neighbor, because as your creature, your children, they deserve our love. And Father, we thank you that you have forgiven us. You forgive us continually, like a Christian. We thank you for your kindness. Your gift, your goodness. Your gift. And Father, we thank you that we can come before you, opening our hearts and our mouths to supplication, with request, to spread before you our need. We know that you know everything. You know our words before the Lord is coming. You know the desires that we have and the key resources of our hearts. Father, we lift the congregational families to you. The swimming, first Catholic, Ralph, and Carol Camino. Father, they bless us. They bless you. And we ask you to bless us. And Father, we know that you tell us trouble for you, repeatedly. Because you do not have all my answer when you are told. If we ask for the parents and the good times, sometimes those are the good times, the day, sometimes they are. But let us continue. How we always pray for you. Pray, Lord. Father, we ask you to bless God. And to be able to give us pleasure, gratitude, and honor. Father, we ask you to bless God. And 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 we ask you to bless God. Father, give us supernatural wisdom and spirit. We lift God to you in honor. Father, give us your honor and honor yourself. Mm-hmm. Father, we ask that you will bless us. Father, we ask that the word will be given to God. The shoulders to lean on and the hands to hold. And by what follow your hand to your name. For your cover from cancer. Father, I look forward to your name. Our immune disease, touch our own Lord. Father, I ask you to bless God and to come into his spirit. Father, we ask you to strengthen his heart. Father, we ask you to look forward to his name. For grace. Father, we ask you to bless the upcoming videos. Father, we ask that your hearts will be blessed. Father, we ask that the kingdom of God will become every video this year. Father, we ask that not necessarily in this but down the line, that there will be peace. Mm-hmm. Father, that your life will be what? The knowledge that you will. Mm-hmm. Father, as we go into school, high school, especially in the workplace, that the faith they have will not be shaken. That this world will not stand against us. Give me strength in my heart to fight off the arrows of my life. Father, we ask for safety that is given our country, globally, and around. Keep them safe and bless us. Father, we ask for you, Lord, for this morning. Father, give us this morning to you. Bless us what we need to do. Father, give him extraordinary spiritual leadership. Let him know spirit. Let his ministry be received. Fill his heart. The Lord.
Final song of prayer.
morning is hymn number 431, Shine, Jesus, Shine. May that be the message of BBS. May that be the message of our children. May that be the message of our church. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the dark. Is shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us.
Knowing that you are children of God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.